Y'all here at OS Reviews, you're watching our retro throwback review of the Moto X second generation here in 2019. This phone was released in 2014, making it now 5 years old. Time really does fly, and we're going to find out if it's still a device that is usable slash maybe worth picking up for a really budget price. Speaking of, this phone can now be found on Amazon or eBay in used condition for around $50. So it's definitely in budget territory, and that's of course without a contract. Now the Moto X is unique because at the time Motorola was pushing for customization. It allowed you to engrave the back of the case if you wanted to write your name or a logo on it. So it's a very cool touch. Furthermore, Moto X was never a super expensive phone despite having flagship specifications. For example, it sold for only around $300 at the time. Taking a closer look at the design, I think the phone has held up quite well in terms of how it looks and feels overall. The frame is constructed out of aluminum, so it does feel extremely sturdy, and then it curves gently upwards towards the center, making it feel more comfortable when gripping it in the hands. It's a very Sony-like design in that sense. Now on the bottom here, we have access to the micro USB port for charging. Inside there is a 2300 milliamp hour capacity battery, which is definitely on the small side, especially if you're picking up a used model as the battery will degrade. So it's one of the less impressive elements of the phone. Otherwise, there is the Qualcomm Snapdragon 801 processor inside, which is quad-core. The 800 and 801 architecture were both really ahead of their times, and even today, if you're just using it lightly, it still is a super responsive experience. Other hardware additions included a 5.2-inch Full HD AMOLED display, which is always nice to see, so we have that really inky black contrast, and Motorola also implemented a series of infrared sensors, which allows you to wave in front of the display when it's, say, sitting on your desk at night to quickly see the time and also basic notifications. Now, the design language for the Moto X was also used on the Nexus 6 because Motorola produced that particular phone for Google. Speaking of, the rear also features a 13-megapixel autofocus enabled camera and an interesting dual LED array, which is in the shape of a ring. Motorola's claim is that it diffuses the light more evenly, similar to selfie light rings. And from a design perspective, it also makes it look a bit more simple and elegant. It has the same diameter as the dimple. On the left-hand spine of the phone, you find access to a volume rocker and a power key, which is very nicely textured and easy to click on, super tactile and responsive, and on the very top, there's a standard 3.5mm headphone jack and a SIM card slot. As a size comparison, here it is next to the Motorola Z, which is of course a newer phone, but you can see how the Moto X's design overall still holds up fairly well, and we still have a kind of a similar design with the camera, everything being completely round and centered from Motorola. The phone came originally with Android 4.4 KitKat, but has since received updates to Android 6.0 Marshmallow, and access to a fairly up-to-date version of all the apps can still be downloaded from the Play Store really without any problems. So this is pretty similar to a stock Android phone, if for example a Pixel phone that has this on the left-hand side. Some of the only additions from Motorola included a customization app, which allows you to further tweak the voice assistant. The trigger word can be completely customized, which is kind of interesting. So you're able to say things like, instead of Google, you can say, okay, Moto X instead in order to activate it. So, okay, Moto X. There's also a handful of motion gestures that Motorola allows you to customize. Things like you can wave the phone to silence it, you can also twist it in order to access the camera, so if we do a quick demo of that, and now we are into the camera interface. So this is a pretty unique and useful addition to quickly launch into the camera no matter where you are, even if the phone's display is turned off. The camera performance is average. Even back in the day, it was not really a contender for other iPhones and Galaxy devices, but again, this is more of a mid-tier priced device, so it was still quite reasonable. The software is very simple. We can simply drag around this focus dial to change the point where we want to focus the camera at, and we can also use this little dial here to change the exposure level, and we can swipe from the side to bring up a carousel view of additional features, including auto HDR, changing the flash. When you hold the phone still, it still does capture decent looking results. Again, 13 megapixels is still a pretty good resolution. Now, the key word here, though, is you have to be a little bit patient because not all photos will turn out outstanding. You do need to have a little bit of trial and error, but still the overall colors that you're capturing do look pretty realistic, and again, the level of detail is also quite good, especially considering the age of the phone. Although again, it's not going to be the best experience if you are capturing shots indoors or when the light starts to go down. A few more shots here, this one captured using HDR. You can see it's still retaining some detail in the clouds, so overall a pretty impressive experience there. And here are some other images and wallpapers that Motorola has installed by default. That's a little bit more than what you'll get from stock Android, so you can pick your favorite ones and of course download more if you don't like the ones which are included that you're seeing right now. Otherwise, let's take a closer look at the video watching experience using YouTube next. The overall quality is actually really good, thanks to the fact that the speaker is pointing directly at you. Even though on the Moto X, it's not a stereo speaker, it's only coming out from the bass and not from the earpiece, unfortunately, but it still gets surprisingly loud, and it also is quite clean sounding. It doesn't distort even when you're pushing it at higher volumes. Experience is also quite good in terms of scrubbing between parts of the track. You can see it just loads back really quickly. Wi-Fi reception strength is also really great on the Moto X. It's helped by all of these integrated antenna bands, and also the polycarbonate backing just helps the antenna pass through without any issues. Next, let's take a closer look at the web browsing performance by jumping into Chrome and see how it fares on a complex site. It is using the Google keyboard, by the way, so it is quite comfortable and supports swipe. Very responsive experience. Let's try The Verge. The phone does have haptic feedback, by the way, so whenever you're tapping on things, it does kind of vibrate to give you the sensation as if you're pressing on a real key or button. The Verge is a pretty complex page in terms of having lots of ads, videos, and small text, but it's handling itself actually pretty well. Now, of course, with an AMOLED screen, the contrast of this page is further exaggerated and giving us a really nice viewing experience. Very clean and crisp, even for small details, easy enough to read. Let's try loading back a different page, perhaps going to, let's say, Amazon, and see how it fares. And once again, it is loading back pretty quickly. Let's try loading up the desktop version of the site to see if it will take longer, but it's actually doing still a really good job. So web browsing remains fast and fluid as long as you have around 5 or 6 tabs or under in the background. If you open up too many tabs, it will start to slow down a little bit because, again, 2 gigabytes of RAM is a little on the low side. But all in all, the Snapdragon 801 chip has been optimized and performs still incredibly well. The last thing that we can take a look at, I think, would just be how it performs in terms of light gaming. Now, believe it or not, the 801 chip can still run, if you want to, heavier titles like PUBG or Asphalt 9. It's just the loading speeds will be a lot longer, but if you are talking about less graphically intensive titles, things like Stack or puzzle-based games, it actually handles without any problems. We can kind of zoom in here, and you can see that once the game is loaded, again, there's not really any drop frames or animations. It still is pretty fast and fluid here. This is kind of a simulation-based game, but everything is, again, running along in the background without too many issues. Overall, it's still loading along really without too much stuttering or delays going on. So once the game is loaded, we are talking about a pretty smooth overall experience. There's also two other apps which are pre-installed called Spotlight and Stories. It's kind of similar to audiobooks with you, but it also immerses the phone by using its accelerometers, so you can also use it with VR headsets and making it kind of a dynamic storytelling experience. You can tilt it and kind of take a look at the world around us, and then it's going to progress through a story. We can also rotate it with our fingers. So this is a nice little kind of additional app that you can also download through the Play Store yourself on different phones, but on this it's pre-installed and it's kind of a fun little touch. So that is more or less it as far as our revisited review of the Moto X, again, the second generation 2014 edition. There is a first generation Moto X, which from 2013, that I probably wouldn't recommend picking up today anymore. A Snapdragon 600 series, it also has a smaller screen, and all around it's not quite as held up as well in terms of its feature set. But the 2014 version has a more kind of iconic design, and still feels extremely solid in terms of the construction quality, and it's just a beautiful phone to hold and interact with. The screen is super sensitive and fluid, thanks to the 2.5D curves, and the Snapdragon 800 series still remains a really fluid chipset in terms of daily navigation and UI interaction, as you can see here. For the price price, I'd say this is definitely still a very usable phone if you're using it primarily for making phone calls, watching some YouTube videos with, doing some light gaming, and answering things like email. So you can see it still is quite zippy and fast. Going to be a lot faster still than many new phones at this price running on a MediaTek chip, for example. Now the device itself's weaknesses would be the battery size, which is definitely showing its age a little bit. This is by no means an endurance champion. However, it does support Qualcomm's quick charging, so you can top it up relatively quickly. Lastly, this is a phone that's not going to be completely up to date in terms of security patches. So if you are getting this phone primarily to use for work, then you may want to think twice. But if you're not too conscious about security and you just want something that works well, again, for personal use, it definitely still more than suffices, and you can download the latest games and titles from the Play Store. The widgets are also updated really without any problems. So you can check out more details if you are interested in the links down below, but for now, that's been our video. Thanks for watching here at OS Reviews. That's been the pretty iconic in terms of design and still surprisingly functional Motorola Moto X 2nd generation here in 2019.